She's toured with the likes of Rachel Yamagata, Ricky Skaggs, Aoife O'Donovan, just to name a few. And she'll be at the Riot Room tonight. Margaret Glaspy, down the hallway in Studio A with our own Jon Hart here on the bridge.
We feel so incredibly lucky to have our guest in today, Margaret Glaspy. Margaret is, just getting started. Your first album isn't out quite yet. And I just hope and pray that people pay attention today, because this is going to be good. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much for having me.
So Emotions and Math comes out June 17th. You've had a couple of self-release things, but this is going to be different.
Yeah, definitely. This is, I suppose, my first kind of big full-length record.
You know, the thing that I kind of love about this record, and we'll get into this a little bit more, but your lyrics are really great. And Emotions and Math is sort of like self-descriptive.
Yeah, I suppose so. Yeah, that song, I don't always love to talk about the song meanings too much, because I like it when people can have their own experiences, but that song, I suppose, I feel like it describes me in a lot of ways. Very analytical, but also very emotional at the same time. I suppose it's everybody in lots of different ways, but it felt like a cool title for the record, because it feels like it kind of encapsulates everything in life.
Yeah. We'd love to hear some music if we could.
Yeah, totally. I think I'll play the title track of the record. This is Emotions and Math.
Just when you're gone, I start to snooze the alarm, 'cause I stay up until 4 in the morning, counting all the days till you're back. I'm shivering in an ice cold bath of emotions and math. Oh, it's a shame and I'm to blame, 'cause we're all right until you go and I start losing control without a warning. Counting all the days till you're back. I'm shivering in an ice cold bath of emotions and laugh. I've got to get out of this tree, oh, off of this limb. I'm a woman acting like a kid, a skinny mess that's breathless from telling you all of the things that I'm gonna do.
I really love that. You know, I cannot wait to finally get this record in.
Yeah, totally.
You know, I'm sure that you feel the same way.
I do.
Long time coming. You know, it's sort of like you do all this preparation, you try and put things in order. But I'm just going to jump around a little bit because that performance, you grew up in a musical family. You said that you were really informed by Joni Mitchell's Blue and all of that. But you've got that snarl. You've got, you kind of spit the lyrics out. Where did that come from?
You know, I think I'm not really sure in certain ways. I think that there's definitely, I think that there's, everybody's kind of made up of all these different pieces, and you're kind of born into the world and you go through it and you grow up, God willing. And I suppose there's been lots of different influences in my life musically. One of these, I suppose maybe a snarly person. I'm trying to think of where that one comes from, but I really don't know. Yeah. I'm trying to like lead it back to one source in my mind. I think that just the combination of music that I've listened to and, you know, experiences that people have, it contributes to your musicality. And I've just ended up where I am now that way somehow. I don't know.
Yeah. Everybody
I've worked on it quite a bit.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's kind of the thing that's kind of great about you is that, you know, there's so many pieces of music that we get presented with where it's like a producer's vision. And, you know, you found your voice.
Yeah.
You know, and so you don't need that. Now, you may choose to do that at some point, but you've got a voice and you've got, so that's kind of a beautiful thing.
Thank you.
The you grew up in Northern California, and pretty much everybody in the house played guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's not to say that all their musical tastes were the same.
Yeah, definitely not. Everyone in my family was certainly a musical influence, and I shared a room with my sister when I was young, and so I picked up a lot of the records that she listened to, and I was kind of addicted to our stereo in the hallway, and would kind of just go through my mom and dad's, you know, CDs and records or whatever for fun. And I look back on that time when I was like, you know, between all my life, but between like 7 and 13 or something, these kind of real particular years when I was at home just kind of searching around for fun things to do when you're a kid. And I really think that that was a big influential period for me. I think just like everybody, but I discovered a lot of records that I still think about now, like, wow, even though I listened to such different music than I listened to then, I think those informed me a lot when I was really young.
Yeah. You, the town that you grew up in, small little town, but they had a fiddle competition.
Yeah, they did.
You got one when you were in third grade.
Yeah, so I started playing the fiddle when I was in third grade, and then I went on to continue to play the fiddle until I was about 15 or 16. And I did it competitively, so I played Texas-style competitive fiddling, I suppose. And so I'd go to competitions all the time. They were in Oregon and Idaho and California, and get to miss school and stuff, which is kind of fun at that age. I was introduced to a lot of professional musicians that way when playing the fiddle, and then kind of start to understood that there was a whole lifestyle and career path around being a musician that time. And then when I was a teenager, I kind of put the fiddle down and started to sing and play guitar, and that's, I really felt really attracted to that and felt like I had arrived at something for sure.
So I'm going to put words in your mouth and try and say something back to you that you just said, but it was a little bit of a twist. Those fiddle competitions, those sort of gave you the impetus, like, I've got to leave home to do this.
Well, I suppose the feeling of making something gave me that feeling. Whether it was fiddle competitions or not, I don't really know. But I suppose in traveling, you know, in order to do it, you had to travel, which was really fun. And in order to do it, you had to kind of be open to meeting lots of different kinds of people. And those things really informed just the way I looked at the world. And, you know, I suppose just kind of having an open mind about music and people in general really contributed to the way they thought about art and kind of opened my mind up to know that there are different ways of living. And so it kind of opened my mind up to saying, oh, I think I could, you know, do something crazy for a living, like maybe play music or make art or, you know, contribute in a different way.
You got a $10,000 grant from Young Arts.
Yeah.
And And that enabled you to move to Boston, which just, you know, 18, California, homegirl, you know, sitting around the house playing guitar, playing fiddle, all of a sudden you're going to move to Boston.
Yeah.
It feels pretty brave.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a leap at the time, but it was also felt just like I was absolutely going to do that. Like it made so much sense to me. And it's funny because more in retrospect, I look at it and I'm like, yeah, that actually was kind of bold in certain ways. But for my trajectory, it just felt like the right move and like I was supposed to do that. So all in all, it made so much sense. And looking back on it, I can see, yeah, if you're like just turned 18 and you move across the country, maybe that is kind of a, a big move to make for sure.
So you got to the Berklee School of Music and two things happened. One, you realize it wasn't really a perfect fit and the money ran out. So between those two things, but the thing that you did find was community.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think in some ways it was the perfect fit because it just pushed me around so much. Like maybe it wasn't, you know, I wasn't always dying to go to the particular classes maybe I was signed up for, but at the same time, it made me know what I wanted. So it felt like actually a perfect fit in that way. And I got to meet so many different people and they just kind of rocked my world. Like I was coming from a tiny town in Northern California and then all of a sudden I was just dropped down into this kind of epicenter of, you know, young, you know, men and women that just wanted to do the exact same thing that I was doing and were way better at it than I was. And so all of a sudden I said, oh, wow, I guess I better, you know, really start learning how to write songs, really start practicing and kind of find a little spot for myself that no one else could occupy because that's the only way I'm going to be able to, you know, succeed in anything in this art form, I suppose. So that was kind of my mindset at that time, is find your little spot and run with it.
Yeah. We're speaking with Margaret Glaspy. She's at the Riot Room tonight with Mount Moriah, and we would love to hear another song if we could.
Yeah, totally. I'll play another one from the record. This one is called No Matter Who. It hurts to be dancing round your telephone, wondering if she's at home or doing the same dance. And you pass the time for an hour or two, wishing he was holding you with both hands. But no matter who, let the phone ring. There's no reason to be leaving you guessing. No matter who got you down, even the weakest of the weak have come around. No matter who. Beginning and a tragic end for two lovers but not two friends. Hello, regret. You're thinking God above that you've been loved while wishing you had never met. But no matter who, let the phone ring. There's no reason to be leaving you guessing. No matter who got you down, even the weakest of the weak have come around. No matter who. You could see that man, I know you'd say, still in love, I am still in love. Are you still in love? I'm still in love. Are you thank you.
That was a real treat. We don't have the record yet, right? So that's one we haven't
right,
heard.
Right, so new ones are coming up.
Yeah, I'm so excited. We're in the studio today with Margaret Glaspy. She's going to be playing the Riot Room tonight with Mount Moriah. Emotions and Math, the debut CD on ATO, is out June 17th. You know, so you're in Boston, and you're out of school, but your head's still in it. So you just kept using your student ID and crashing classes, right?
A little bit, yeah.
This story. Are you afraid of a bill coming in the mail?
I think Berkeley is kind of, I mean, I don't want to put words in Berkeley's mouth, certainly, but it has been kind of renowned as a place where people do pass through, and not everyone necessarily graduates, but they kind of use it to their advantage. And you know, you give them all your money, and then you get exactly what you want back. I snuck into a master class or two and would see some teachers on their office hours and things like that. And I was so hungry for, you know, just somebody to push me and to get some kind of input on the things that I was making, that I definitely, you know, sought it out by any means necessary, and still like to sign up for that these days as well. So, that was kind of my mode of operation when I was there. When I did the young arts thing, it was essentially, it's kind of a grant, but it's essentially like they just write you a check and you can do whatever you want with that. And so I choose to just put it towards school. And once that ran out, I knew that I was just going to go very far into debt. And so I said, I can't quite do that right now. And I left school technically, but I hung around quite a bit.
So just to be in that community and to make a living, you took the odd jobs, worked in a bakery for a while.
Yeah.
And your hands might have been in the dough, but your mind was writing lyrics.
Certainly, yeah. I mean, I found certain jobs to be kind of perfect for what I did, like washing dishes was perfect because your hands were busy, but you could just do whatever you wanted the entire time. So that was kind of a writing time for me. I worked in a bookstore for a while too. That was also great because you're shelving books and, you know, you can do whatever you want again in your head. So those jobs were kind of amazing because it just gave me time to, you know, I miss that time in certain ways because it's just this time where you're able to kind of work on things and, you know, you're still making money at the same time, but I was able to kind of work on things in my mind in a way that was really fun for me.
You know, when you very first started writing songs, from what I've read, you weren't so sure that you wanted to just let everybody know everything that was happening in your life. So you disguised it a little bit. And then you got to be a little bit more like, I'm just going to put it out there.
Well, I think the way that I view songwriting is pretty objective in a way. I mean, no matter what you do, in anything you do, I suppose you're putting yourself into it. And so I feel that way about songwriting very much so, where I actually view it as a craft for sure and a job. And of course, there's things in my life that get in there, certainly. There was certainly a time when I would make it so that I was writing songs and I would make it my job to make it so I was not involved, like, really intensely. And that was kind of an exercise in ways and, you know, kind of a challenge. And now I do feel a little bit more like, service the song and let that just breathe and do its thing. And, you know, people can associate whatever they want to the music I make. I don't care.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. It just feels like doing all the interviews that musicians fall into one of two camps. They either had intention that they clearly want the listener to understand and they want to get their intent across, or they've done their job and now the listener gets to finish the song and take whatever they want, however wrong-headed it might be, right away from it.
You can't have much control after you release a record in a certain way where, you know, people will say really interesting things to me after they listen to a song of mine where I just didn't even, I can't even believe that you got that from that song. And it's really interesting and really kind of magical that people, whatever place you're in, you take a song lots of different ways.
So you were in Boston for about 3 years, and then you decided, you know, you sort of bounced back and forth to do a few things here and there, and New York sort of called you.
Yeah, definitely. So I can't remember how old I was. I think I was probably about 21, just maybe newly 21. And I think I knew at a young age that I'd probably end up in New York in some capacity at some point in my life. And so that also wasn't a surprise to me. It felt like it fit really well. That said, you know, New York's a crazy place, and landing in New York and just saying, okay, I live here now, was kind of wild at first. But that said, it's just such a magical place to be. It's so amazing there, and I really love it.
You know, one of the things that happened in New York was you all of a sudden sort of started gravitating towards electric.
Yeah, totally.
And, you know, we're a lot more used to seeing people who come in here doing solo things standing up with an acoustic.
Right, interesting.
So what was behind the choice?
I kind of was always headed in this direction. I think there was some people that I feel like, well, maybe it's not even like an influence thing, but maybe just more of a sonic thing. I like how the electric guitar actually makes a lot of sense to me because it kind of sustains in this way and takes up a certain amount of room that I appreciate. It also feels like I can play, while I feel like you can do this on the acoustic guitar too, somehow this just makes more sense to me, and I can play solo and feel like I'm playing bass and the guitar at the same time, which, I don't know, it just feels like it's kind of more all-encompassing for the songs that I'm making personally. That said, I play acoustic guitar all the time still, but I like performing electric with the songs that I'm making a little bit more right now. Also, I feel like I was playing in New York City all the time, and it was harder to mic an acoustic guitar at the clubs I was at. It was so much easier to just plug into an amp that it kind of just started to streamline that way, where, you know, try and mic, put a condenser and a good little acoustic guitar and a really noisy bar. And it's just, you can kind of get a little bit washed out. And so I liked this a lot because it was really immediate and direct, and it just made sense for New York City for sure.
Yeah, I think people are going to hear your voice first, and then they're going to recognize that there are songs there, and then they're going to figure out that you can play a guitar.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, so you got a gig opening up for the Alabama Shakes at CMJ.
Oh, yeah, right. So I did, it wasn't necessarily the Alabama Shakes, but it was Brittany Howard's...
Thunder Bitch.
Yeah, right, her side project, which was great. And that was my first kind of show, kind of showcasing as an ATO artist, which is really cool. I'm so happy to be on that label. And it's been, their roster is really rad, and kind of, you know, being around Brittany and also just all the other artists there is really cool.
So you had recorded the record Emotions and Math that's coming out June 17th. You'd recorded that in your bedroom. Mm-hmm. And then you decided, you know, I'm going to go buy some gear and do that again. So you bought some gear, moved it in, recorded the album again. Then you got the deal with ATO. And they said, here's somebody to go into the studio. So you actually have recorded this album three times.
Three times, yeah.
Did that help it?
Yeah, totally. It felt like a total production process. I mean, I produced the record, and it was just inevitable that I would, and I feel like it kind of taught me to be a producer in a certain way. And it also just taught me about what records need. Personally, what my records need. And for me, they needed that time for sure. It feels like it took 27 years to make it. I feel like I wish and hope that I can, you know, kind of... I always like to think of it as like you're kind of beating the songs up in a certain way. You're kind of strangling all of the excess out of them so that you can just distill it into its most kind of important form. And I feel like I had the time to do that on this record. So I'm really thankful that I got to, even though when I was doing it, it felt like I was crazy because I had just recorded the record three times over again. It was just couldn't be cooler, really.
You know, I keep coming back to some of the people that you have in your community of friends. You know, all the guys from Wilco, folks from Lake Street Dive, and of course Crooked Still. And, you know, it just, the list goes on and on. It's sort of like you've attracted some really talented, cool people to be your friends and mentors.
Yeah, totally. I take so much, I don't know, I learn a lot from the people that are around me, and people like... Yeah, like my friends in Lake Street Dive or Nels Klein or Julian Lage or just all these wonderful people that are around me. I feel like it's pretty wonderful, and it really keeps you up to your standard. It just pushes me all the time to really want to be the best that I could be.
Well, I think that when this record drops, it's going to be a revelation to a lot of people. You are really, You're really good.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Margaret Glaspy, she's opening for Mount Moriah at the Riot Room tonight. The new album, Emotions and Math, out June 17th. If you go to the show tonight, you can get a two-song vinyl that will give you a taste. And if you pre-order the album, you can get three instant gratification tracks right away. So that's pretty cool.
Go get it.
Margaret Glaspy in our studios. We'd love to hear one more song.
Awesome. Thanks so much for having me. This is a song called Somebody to Anybody.
Margaret Glaspy in our studios today here at the Bridge. That was lovely.
Thank you so much.
So tonight, Riot Room and opening for Mount Moriah, the CD Emotions and Math out June 17th, and you can pre-order that now and get those three tracks. You know, there's a quote from your father that I think you're living out right now. Opportunity favors the prepared.
Yes, that's true.
Thanks for everything you're doing.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
Margaret Glaspy tonight at the Riot Room and here today on the Bridge.